there was a regrouping, and I think quite an in-depth evaluation on what had transpired, and was it cost effective to do what we were doing? Wasn't there better ways of conducting these types of operations to be more successful? And Schulenburg was coming into his own in terms of reconnaissance work. He had come back again. I know Andy Chat came back with him, but Andy Chat just wanted to stay in squadron. We had also then got quite a few new people in from RLI who had passed selection. You know, when I think of Paul Clark, Gary Lewis, all of these guys, as well as National Servicemen who had come in and passed. And squadron was now becoming significantly bigger because we were now on continuous call-up, so all these old soldiers had come back. So they split us up now into three squadrons. You had A, B, and C. And each squadron was designated more or less an operating area. And when a camp attack would be planned, the squadron who was back in Arari at that time was more the designated squadron, although there would be other people drawn from the other units as well. So we then got the name from RLI as not SAS but Saturday Afternoon Soldiers, because camp attacks were planned continuously after that. I can't remember them all, you know. And in different areas, most of which were Mozambique, obviously. And some of them were repeat attacks on old camps. And what would happen was, we'd be in barracks, be told, right, we're going to do this attack on the Saturday, because Saturdays or Sundays were always the best time to do it, because the enemy tended to party and drink beer and were hungover the next day. So we did a series of six in a row, all relatively successful, some not as successful as others.
But how were you going in? Were you going in by chopper or by...
By chopper and deck. Mm-hmm. So we would have air support as well. Depending on the size of the camp itself and its location, and how Frelimo was strategically placed. So they would either bomb it with cameras or we would have hunters. And then we would come in. On some of the smaller attacks, like on the other side of the Zambezi River in Zambia, then we would rely on our own mortar team. Snake Allen basically headed that up, and Willem Rutter became very efficient at that as well. And then we would row across, do our camp attack, and come back again. They were always scheduled only to last a couple of days. So every time we would go in and we would conduct the op and then clear the camps, and if we had any captures, SB would come and collect them and take them away for interrogation. And we would collect whatever kit was there and then bring it back again. At the same time, Sulu Scouts were doing a little bit of that on their own, but not really a lot. They were trying to look at bigger fish like mapaya and places like that. It was very stressful. People don't understand how you every weekend know, and your family see all the planes take off, and they don't know who's coming back, and every time you would lose somebody, you know. So you come back and it's this crying and jubilation and all the other things, and obviously lessons learned. But this went on for a while, and people's attitudes changed from where we didn't really initially hate the enemy, but we started to, and there was no quarter asked ever from that time on. So we were being shouted at to take prisoners, but no prisoners were coming back.
What was it that triggered? Was it the atrocities?
What we found in the camps, how they treated their own people, having our own guys killed, the whole thing, you know. When you're coming under continuous fire, when you're jumping out of a deck and being shot at all the way to the ground, it starts to work on you after a while. When you're doing deep ops, on top of that, we also had our own workload, whereby in between these, we would be shipped back to Mabalahuto. And the Russian front was a scary place. I was very lucky. In all the time I operated there, my call sign never was ambushed. Everybody else was, everybody else. We were hunted, but we were shot at. We were very lucky. On one occasion, Darrell Watt decided, he had just been a newly commissioned officer, and he decided we were going to landmine extensively. And Rogan Brown's call sign and mine were given the deepest assignment, probably the oldest boys there. And we were flown in, top by deck, and then told, well, you're 7.5 hours chopper time, so you haven't got any air cover. And when we went out the door, the villagers were waving at us. They knew we were there. So you knew this trouble. And we had 6 mines to lay, each call sign. Rogan's was on the other side of the town and mine was this side of the town. So it was well past those pans. Yeah, right almost onto the coastal highway. And it was thickly infested with Frelimo. I still to this day don't believe that there were many ZANU-PF enemy there. I think our war at that stage was with Frelimo, certainly in the southeast.
Mm.
And they operated in large numbers. Many times I picked up spore of 200-250 call signs. That's a lot of men, you know. And we were 4-man call signs. But anyway, we faced the situation. And that particular mine laying operation, I didn't realize it at the time. Chunky Chesterman and my call sign had broken his leg on impact. Called me and said he hurt his ankle, but I mean, you're 7.5 hours chopper time away. I strapped it up and said, well, can you walk on it? He said, yes. So he was quite a tough bloke. And we had quite a bit of walking to do. And I walked, I knew where the road was. So we had Wayne Ross Smith, Chunky Chesterman, and I think it was Steve Donnelly with us. So we walked to the road, to the main road, which was all sand track. It was probably 8 o'clock at night. And a BTR-90 came steaming down the road. We just pulled back off the road and it went straight past us into the village. The village was probably 1.5 km from us, maybe. So I got on the radio, I told Rogan. And Rogan wanted to leave straight away. He didn't want any part of this. But we couldn't, you can't just leave. So convinced him to lay his mines, we laid ours. Withdrew from that position because I realized we were too close to the enemy. But in hindsight, and it's always 20-20 hindsight, we should have attacked that village from two sides. The two call signs would have been much more effective and we would have caught them by surprise. And I think we would have been okay. But anyway, I withdrew back from the road. We laid all 6 mines that night. I think Rogan laid 3. So I got on the radio back to Bob McKenzie. Said to him, look, the mine's gone off. He said, we know we're monitoring their radio. This is what's happened. This is how many they say are dead at this stage. And funny enough, they came with a demining group with a what's his name?
Metal detector.
They were monitoring their signals back at Mabalahuto. And there was frantic radio communication to wherever, maybe Tet or whatever. And the guy on the radio was saying to the guy in Tet, we have been attacked and we have sent the demining crew out, but the mine detector person has disappeared. He set the mine off because we were laying rose mines, which had a coil around it, magnetic coil around it. And if you made that coil, the mine went off. And so he was asked, well, where is he? No, we can't find him. He's disappeared. So he must have been right on top of the mine when it went off. So they actually regrouped, Frelimo regrouped. They were a bit scared now. They didn't, we didn't know that. But I insisted to McKenzie that we needed to be uplifted because it was open, flat country, sand. Nowhere to go, nowhere to hide. You can't anti-track.
Mm.
So they sent Dick Paxton and Danny Savoda to come and collect us. And they had to refuel at the pans. So they dropped drums there. They carried drums in with them, dropped the drums there. Then came back and collected us and Rogan's call sign. And on the way back, we had to refuel in the pans and then back to Mabaluita. And that's when I saw that poacher in the river.
Shadrick.
As we were coming back to Mabaluita, over the river, the Sabi River, I think it is, there was a whole lot of clothes on the side of a small hill, very thickly wooded, hanging in the trees. And what we didn't see at the time was there was a whole lot of meat drying there. So both call signs were dropped in the riverbed, and we assaulted the position because we thought it was enemy. And these guys had taken off, run into Gonarezu, and we found no traces that they were actually enemy combatants. There was no military stuff there, and they had no notice. And they normally, when we had contacts and the enemy ran, they left all sorts of things, even their shoes behind. Whereas these guys had obviously been traveling very light, had taken whatever meat they could and ran. And the rest of it was lying up there. Anyway, it wasn't worth our while to pursue. So the choppers had already been circling in the air with the K-car, and they couldn't see anything. So they came back down, picked us up, and we went into Mabaluita then to start again. At the same time, they had decided that we needed to do para-envelopment to do this so that RLI could become paratrained and take over, because it was basically what the Yanks had developed in Vietnam. And I think it was probably Bob McKenzie at his instigation. So they said they would, okay, we'll do it in the southeast because it was the hottest area. And I think B Squadron came. Was it B Squadron? I can't remember. I think it was B Squadron came to join A Squadron at Buffalo Range. RLI were also there doing fire force, but they purely went in the helicopters. They got all the alouettes and bells. So what would happen is Sulu scouts were obviously doing the reconnaissance and the contact with the enemy, setting it up, and then they would call us and we would come in. And the way it worked was we would fly in a V and drop, and the RLI guys would block off the back with the helicopters because the helicopters could drop them there. And it was extremely successful. The one contact we had was in Gonarezu itself, right in the middle of Gonarezu, where Grey Scouts had picked up a huge call sign of 75. They didn't, not being very experienced, they didn't recognize the size of the group. And they rode into them and took a huge amount of fire. Fortunately, none of them were hit, and they rode their horses out, and we were called in, and we dropped in. And as we dropped in, I just saw the K-car going mad. It was just firing and firing and firing, and we could feel fire coming to us, but it was way over our heads kind of thing. And we assaulted that position, and I remember Graham Wilson, because I could see him from the side, probably 50 meters away from us, standing up. And it was Jesse Bush, you know, this very short, thick Mopani Bush. And he was talking to the K-car pilot, and the K-car pilot said to him, "Get down, get down, get down. They're right in front of you." And Wilson couldn't see that because he didn't have good eyesight anyway. He wore glasses. But he was very brave, you know. He wasn't a guy that lay down very easily. And he said, "No, I want to see where are they?" And the K-car opened up, not even 50 meters in front of them, which was too close actually for the K-car. And I just saw these four enemy fall out behind them, like an anthill and Jesse Bush. And they were going to shoot him. They were going to shoot Wilson. If the K-car going to have hit them then, you know, I think he might have been killed. But in the initial contact, we killed 45. And then, you know, through various stop groups and that, probably cleaned up, probably of the 75, we probably killed about 65, I think.
I don't remember the body counts, but I'm sure there's others who can give you more precise, because we had to load them in nets. The choppers came in with nets and all the bodies, because the SB had to fingerprint them all. So we loaded all the bits and pieces in the nets, and we picked up whatever kit and stuff was there, and it was flown back to Mabaluhuta. And they just came in, I think there must have been about 6 chopper loads of them, bodies just being dropped at the end of the airstrip, where they, when they finished with it, they just dug a big hollow groove in there and just threw them all in and covered them up after it. But that was the first very successful para envelopment. And we all went back to Grand Reef, and we no sooner got back the next day, the next morning early, we were called by Andy Balaam, the scouts, with another big group. And we were picked up again. I was picked up in chopper, my call sign, and we were flown into the contact area, and we killed another 32 in that contact. So then they said, right, this system works, and we're going to start training RLI to become para efficient, because they didn't want us doing fire force. Mm-hmm. Although we were effective and efficient at it, it wasn't our call. So they wanted us to get the southeast under control. So we were designated with gathering intelligence, putting a lot of mines down, a lot of ambushes, and unfortunately we lost quite a few people in A Squadron over that period because of extreme contact with Frelimo. Every day you would have a contact. There was no doubt about it. I remember old Roger the Dodger, Roger Bite the Bullet McDonald, in the one contact. That was Stu Patterson's call sign. They got ambushed. That was pretty hectic for them. Really tough. We had a RLI officer, I can never remember the guy's name, Lou himself, and Cornet for Mark, and the other guy up laying mines.
Tyrone.
That's him. And unfortunately, poor old Bruce Stavner was the schoolboy first op with these three bodies in the middle of Mozambique, being told to wait there until the next morning because the choppers couldn't come and collect them that night. It must have been horrific. And then, only then could he come back again. So, you know, those were just incidents that happened. We had guys wounded.
Barry, you were involved in a couple of attempts to kill Tom Bagara.
Yes. Yes, okay, that also came in those periods. Andre Skippers did his freefall course with us. He was not an officer at all. He was a troopie at that stage. Alan Hyde and myself and Paul French, and I can't remember the whole group. But anyway, we were designated to do a Pathfinder course. And we became quite good friends, Andre Skippers and myself. Then he went away to go and do officer's course, but was told that he would, on completion, have to go to RLI. And when he finished at RLI, if he wanted to come back to SAS, he had to do selection again. And of course, you know, he got wounded in contact in RLI. But he had a good time there and learned to become a very good officer. Andre was always, you know, quite a clever bloke. He wasn't, you know, any fool by any means. And was a very good officer. He then came to A Squadron as a loot. Had been wounded, etc., and formed part of extensive operations into the Russian front with us. Of course, Lutz was our sergeant major. We were then asked to go to to Grand Reef, and then to look at a camp that Salu scouts had tried to do ops on, or tried to do OPs on, and they called it. Was it Monte Cassino? And they had good in that there was extensive Russian involvement, and this was a build up to invading Rhodesia, a sort of end of the war thing, conventional warfare thing.
Yeah.
And the information we'd received was that Tonga Gara said he would not retreat and that he was resident in this camp. We had an escaped enemy combatant who turned, and we also had MNR, Mozambique National Resistance guys with us, good operators, who had fallen foul of Frelimo for one or another reason and defected. These guys were put together with myself, my call sign, Andre, Skipper's call sign, of course, Lutz's call sign. And I was to command the pathfinding area. Andre Skipper's was to go with the M&R and this other guy with his call sign to do the recce. Of course, Lutz went off to another designation to be support and backup in case there was trouble. And what actually happened was they got into the general area of the camp.
And the mission was to kill Tom Garner.
Well, yes and no. Yes and no. Initially, it was to establish that it was there. Then the whole of squadron would come. In the marshalling area, the planning to do the attack would take place. And Skippers would be designated the night before to go into Tongogara's tent and kill him and come out, because it would have caused huge disruption when their camp attack took place. This enemy soldier said he was Tongogara's batman and knew exactly where he was and how he slept and his habits and all the rest of it. So anyway, they got into the general area, but it was a very difficult, once again, very thickly wooded terrain. If you've seen it from the air, see aerial photographs of it, you'll understand what I'm saying. And very well disguised and spread over a huge area. And there was a big Frelimo camp also close by, the battalion strength of Frelimo. So this was very important to them, the enemy. Okay. And Andre then sent the M&R guy and this enemy combatant to go to the village to find out a bit more information so that he could approach it from the right angle to get into it, because it was spread over such an area and there were trenches and defences and the Russians had gone overboard, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And this big mountain where they had all the anti-aircraft up on it, you know, quad 32s and whatever. So they had a witch doctor in their camp, and the witch doctor predicted this and said these guys are coming to attack us, and you know, and while these guys were in this asking these locals, they were compromised by a ZANU PF Terrence patrol and they had to run. So the whole op was compromised and they withdrew to our marshalling area where we picked them up. Unfortunately, there was a contact from Kurs Lutz's call sign on a poacher who had shot a sable with his two sons. And they walked into them. And Kurs shouted at the guy not to run. And the two kids ran. I was put on the back burner and we were asked whether we were prepared to go in a much bigger force or call sign, a 12-man call sign, to do a complete OP on this, where this camp was. So there were four M&R guys with us. We didn't take this enemy guy because we didn't trust him. And we had Dave Westerhout with us as a sniper, because both Franz and Dave, what's his name?
Westerhout.
The English guy, Tommy guy. They were doing ops.
O'Sullivan,
they were doing other ops. And so he had been seconded and he was keen as mustard, this guy. Obviously he was a good shot. And he was purely designated that if we saw Tongogara, he was to shoot him at all costs. That was it. So we went back in. And I was always, I had very good eyesight and I was always put in the front, leading the guys in on virtually every op. And I picked up the spoor and it was Dave very directly behind me and then Andre Skippers. And the path was about a meter wide and it was just boot tracks. I knew we were close. It was running alongside the road. So it was obvious that they cleared that area every day. It was a wide road. You can just imagine how many people walk down that if it's a meter wide. So I indicated that there must be enemy here. So we withdrew 15 meters into thick vegetation, and two trucks went past us full of camouflage, but heading in the opposite direction. So Andre Skipper surmised that actually we weren't close to the camp, and it's still further because those trucks must be going there. So we went up the mountain, and we didn't know we were sitting right in the middle of it at that particular stage. We could hear nothing, we couldn't see anything. Very thick trees. I think I've given you photos of it, where we're sitting there, you know. And he went off, Andre decided to go off with Dave Berry, and left Dave West out with me and the rest of the call sign on top of the mountain. And they were going to go and find out, if they could find out exactly where this camp was. So they went down the other side and went off towards the power lines. And they spoke to civilians there, the Frelimo guys. They acted as if they were ZANU-PF tourists, and they were lost and they needed to find this camp. And these civilians said, no, you've just come from it. It's right there. It's there. So Andre realized the faux pas and legged it back to us. Got to us and said, hey guys, it's right here. Are your early warnings out? And I said, yes, I've placed two guys out there. And there's this side we covered. We can see the whole road in front of us. There's no sooner were the words out of my mouth and old Chunky Chesterman came running up to me, Barry, Barry, there's enemy coming. So I picked up my RPD, threw my kit on, but by the time I got there, they'd had the contact. I mean, I was probably 15 meters from them when they opened up. So I ran down to you, opposite their position, and there were four dead enemy lying, and I saw two running through the trees at about probably 150 meters away. So we picked up whatever kit they had. The one was dressed in a VSAP blue outfit with an FN. So he must have turned, you know, yeah, joined them. Yeah, well, he joined the enemy, okay. So Andre was shocked. He, you know, at that stage it was, you know, compromise of note. And
you're surrounded.
And we're surrounded because we heard all the AA open up. It was firing anywhere, just everywhere. So, Dave, myself, Andre, Dave Berry, myself, Andre Skippers, spoke, and we decided we've got to get down back across that road. We've got comms with Johnson, actually Barry Deacon and Pretorius was sitting on a forward mountain in Chimoni Moni as our relay. So we told them what had happened and where we were going. And they must get the choppers airborne now, because we think there's going to be trouble. We're going to have a hot extraction here. So we went down, back straight back down the way we'd come up, went across the road, and Andre said, no, we're laying an ambush, we're not running. So we did, right there and then. And he sent Dave van Bredaal with RPG to the road. We were 25 meters from the road probably, and two Land Cruisers came out, and a whole lot of combatants running behind them and a couple on them. Well, they were confused, you know, it was a real confusing setup, but they were roaring out of camp. We didn't see the Russians at that time in the Land Cruisers. So Dave van Bredaal, he waited, give him his due. And the one pulled over to the side and waved to the other one, come past, and as he came past, poof, initiation. So we shot them all. I don't really know how many we killed, because Dave Berry and myself ran forward, because Andre said, get to the vehicles and see what we can get. But they were on fire. So we ran forward and we could see, these don't look like black guys. We're not sure about this one now. We thought we'd actually killed some Red Cross people, because you couldn't see in the fire and smoke and everything. But we'd taken out the two Land Cruisers. And there were other bodies lying around there that had obviously been there backup or whatever. But whoever had been left ran straight back into Monte Cassino. We then withdrew 200 meters. And there was a village there, and they'd all run away. And Andre, I don't know what his thoughts were, but he thought we were safe. And him and Dave Berry and Westerhout had pulled out these, you know, these guys make those chopped wooden chairs that sort of round like this. They were sitting on them and they were playing. And I had him and our guy with me, or Corporal Richard, who was a smart hacky, real smart hacky, and we were watching the back. And he said to me, "They're coming." I said, "Where? I can't see them." "Oh, there. They're looking at me." "Where?" He said, "No, there." Dave van der Doel said, "Barry, I can see them." He said, "It's a woman in front, and there's two or three behind." I said, "Have they got weapons?" "Yes, they're following our spoor." So I said, "Ooh." And I looked, and then I saw them. Because they, when they spoke to me, these guys had just moved behind the ant hill. That's why I didn't see them. Because we must have run around that ant hill to our position. We didn't, you know, I didn't think at the time. And as they came round, I said, "Right, we're going to take them all." Okay. We took our time, because normally these M&R guys just fire. They just, you know, open up.
Speak up a little bit.
Yeah. But, you know, I had an RPD, David had nothing, and we just planted. As we opened fire, oof, I don't know how many enemy force were to our left where Andres Kippers was playing in the village. And they just about shot him off that chair. It was just a wall of tracer. Just came through. You know, it's a sound that you can't really describe to someone. You know, the volume of fire was just unbelievable. But fortunately for us, once again, they feared us more than we feared them, so they were shooting high. And but the rounds were coming all around us, but not accurate as such. But it was mowing all the grass down. We were in quite long spear grass, and it just cut it like a mower, just cut it straight down. And all the trees, all the bark was coming off the trees. And then the 32s, they managed to level them down. And they started firing from the mountain onto us, and then they were dropping mortars onto us. At the same time, Johnson had come in a push-pull as the contact happened. And fortunately, they carried a 500-pound bomb. And we were trying to talk to him and tell him, "Listen, you can't get the choppers can't land. They can't land. Under this fire, we'll lose all the choppers. We have to withdraw from here. We have to move back." Because these guys were now wanting to assault us. You know, they've taken quite heavy losses, though, I must admit, because I shot a further three that had jumped up behind bushes to just to our left. So on that contact, I saw these guys get up, and so I planted them. And then, as I say, the return fire from us in that direction obviously took out quite a few as well. We were under very heavy fire, and he instructed the pilot to fly directly over this gunfire without thinking he's being on the same level as the AA fire from the mountain. And it just was like a Roman candle coming around him in that aircraft. I thought the aircraft was going to get shot down. I really don't. That Cessna. And the pilot, how he maintained his composure, I don't know. But he dropped that bomb. And when that bomb went off, it just went silent. Just, you know, everybody just silent. It gave us the opportunity then to call the choppers to land. We ran back probably 2 km to an open area. It was this red, hard, packed soil. And the choppers fortunately came in. But the other guys left, and they told me my call sign was lost. And as we lifted off, the tech said to me, "Look." And here they came. They were 15 meters from us. They must have been maybe 300 at least. But they didn't shoot at us. They could have shot us down. They didn't shoot at us. I don't know why, because up to that point they were shooting at us. But as that chopper landed and picked us up, I don't know why.
And you got divine providence.
Divine providence. And we flew back to Maori Dams and got off all the choppers there. Discussed everything. Then flew back to Grand Reef. And then back to
Ilori. Barry, just talk us through the your recollections of the Chamoyo.
Yeah, Chamoyo. Okay. Dick Biederman's call sign and my call sign had been seconded to Matt McIntosh and Coventry. This was during that continuous call up. Sort of more towards the end of it. And we were given, I was asked to go and look at the big warehouse. Just across the border of Villa Peri, there was a railway warehouse there. And they believed that they had shipped tanks into there and they were getting ready to attack Umtali. So they needed confirmation of that. Mac Mackintosh was alert with Coventry and they were doing intelligence.
Mm-hmm.
So we were sent there and Dick Biederman's call sign was sent to go and relook at the camp attack that Wilson had done at
Mabondi.
That there was nothing, no one was there. You know, obviously they were instructed not to go in because Wilson had put a whole lot of booby traps and everything was mined. So it was quite hazardous. You couldn't get close to it. And I think that's obviously why no one came back again. They probably tried and just got, you know, blown up. So while he was there, we were young. And we went down, and Delange and myself, and we went right at night to the warehouse, and it had a mesh security fence around it. The railway line ran right there past it, like it, on the way to Umtali. So we made our way in and we could look through the building, through the doors, and there was nothing. There wasn't anything inside there. So we withdrew because it was dangerous. Mackintosh himself had been chased out of there and had suffered some pretty PTSD because of it. They were badly chased. Very lucky. Three guys actually left squadron after that thing of his because they were shot, they were finished, they couldn't take it anymore. Young guys. I'm not going to mention their names. But anyway, so we came back and we told them we withdrew back to our position, which was just by a timber mill there. And Coventry actually came on the radio and said to me, well, we want you, we're going to move you to the Hondi Valley. And then while you're up there, we want you to go and look at this camp on the other side of the Pungwe. We've got a lot of information about this thing and we believe there's a big camp there, but it's very heavily populated area. Are you prepared to do it? And this was right in the middle of the rainy season and it was just every day pouring rain. You know how it rains there in that flipping area, tea plantations. Anyway, so we said yes, but he said, just understand there's no air cover. We don't command respect from any organization. And officially, you're not supposed to be working for us anyway, so, but be careful and see what you can do. And Coventry was a nice guy, was it? Yeah, tough old guy. So we went, and I had Gordon Kuma with me, and Phil Tulland, and Steve Donnelly, and myself, so it was four-man call site. So we had to make our way, across the Pungwe River, which was in full flood, which was a murder exercise. You know, eventually we found where the locals were crossing, so we went across at night. We can't go in the daytime, so many poor heads. Packed. So, and we walked barefoot all the way. And we got into the area of this Nyamumba farm. That's what it was called. It wasn't called Chamoya, it was called Nyamumba farm. And we were told to go and look at it. It was an old Portuguese farm. And they believed that it had been given to ZANU-PF and there was this camp. So they advised us to approach it from the area where it's got a lot of ridges and huge trees, massive 60-foot thick trees, indigenous stuff, you know, because the locals didn't want to locate there because they were very rocky and there was no agricultural land. So we walked and we came up over the first ridge and we came up over the second ridge at first light and we looked out over this parade ground. And it was extensive. And there were, look, I estimate now, but we asked at the time, we said, can we not get a camera to photo this? Because you were not going to believe us. We didn't have cameras. We see, you're not going to believe how many there are. Yeah, we see. So they flew a camera over and they estimated there were 11,000 enemy on parade. Sorry. So I said, no, I'm leaving now. We're moving. And my guys were panicking and we left.
Not 1,100, 11,000.
11,000.
Yes.
They, for some reason, they were having a big thing. There was a Red Cross ambulance there. There was a big do thing going on. I don't know what it was, but they were all there. They had, if I can describe it, they had these little chairs that were crossed like this. And they had all their weapons on those, you know, sort of packed around those. And then some were kneeled down in front and then there were more behind and this obviously a dress going on, but we didn't stay. I wasn't interested, I wasn't gonna stay there. We were already in a bad position, as it were. You know, our clothes were falling off us. They had rotted from being in the rain the whole time. So we withdrew, and we got picked up, and then we were told, well done, guys. It's really good stuff. Dick Biederman had had a contact on the other side where they'd shot to Frelimo or something. So it was time for us to get out. So we went back to Harare, and it was the end of continuous call-up. And we were all thanked for our bit that we'd done and now to go home. So it was now to try and look for a job. And unfortunately, we were unemployable because we would be called up at any time. So no one wanted to give us employment. There were quite a few of us. Lawrence Castaigne, my friend, was one of them. And his father was the biggest tobacco farmer in Rhodesia in those days. And quite an influential man, Coral Castaigne, in his own right. Anyway, he decided that he's going to take us into Parliament to speak to the Deputy Minister of Agriculture, who was Taylor's uncle, Graham Taylor's uncle, from Merendellis. So we went and we laid our case, you know, why can't we be employed? You know, we prepared to farm for anybody. You know, we know what we're doing. We're good, honest, upright citizens. But he's in Salus Scouts and I'm in SAS, and they want to call us up every couple of months or whatever it is. We've got to go and do call-ups at a moment's notice, every camp attack, every whatever, you know. So we have to go. And the farmers went, they didn't have money, they couldn't afford to pay people who weren't there.
Mm-hmm.
So you could understand both sides of the equation. So anyway, he demanded to see this guy, Coral, and of course the guy's going to listen to this guy because he's the biggest tobacco grower in Rhodesia. So we go into the office and we sit down and we talk to him, and he questions us quite closely. He was quite a bombastic, okay, but quite a nice guy actually, really. And he said, but, you know, you've just finished your call-ups, and so, you know, I can't remember the exact question, but it was something to do with, so, well, why do you feel so offended that you're not going to be employed? So I said, well, listen, I feel offended because you guys don't want to take these guys out. We've just done this. We've seen them, and you're not doing anything about it. And people are being killed every day, and you're doing nothing. And he said to me, I don't know what you're talking about. Come here, come and see Rowan Cronier, who's a minister of whatever he was. Can't remember what he was actually, but he was the main owner. So, because we were demanding to see the Prime Minister, we wanted to see Smith. We were full of it. You know, we were nothings actually. But, so he took us to Rowan Cronier, so we sat down. So I said, look, I'm not really allowed to tell you this, but this is basically the thing, and this is where it is, and this is what we saw. And Coral Castaigne said, listen, gentlemen, if you're not prepared to do something about this, I'm going to the press. Just like that.
The fact that there is this big camp and...
Because Flowers, who was sitting at Commons, had the say. Mm. And he wasn't going to let us do this.
No, you're right. He would have been stalling it.
Yes.
But what we didn't know, or I wasn't aware of, Mac McCrimmon and Robinson and all of them knew about this splash for some time and had been planning, and they couldn't get permission.
That's true. Mm.
And now Rowan Cronier said, just wait here, gentlemen. Got it. Walked straight into Ian Smith's office and said to him, listen, I've got two young soldiers sitting in my office and they're telling me this story. And this is unacceptable. How can you allow this to take place in your army, you know? And Rowan Cronier was a pacifist, actually. He was a
Germany.
But he was on our side, which was quite nice, you know, because we could hear them talking. So anyway, we were told to bugger off with our tails between our legs. Don't ever speak of this again. And not within, it was a couple of months at the most, because I had managed to get a job with a guy called Derek Scott, who had just won Maize Grower of the Year in Montreal, World Maize Grower of the Year. Tremendous farmer out in Northern, very good. Big, huge, what you would call a mega buria, you know. I mean, he had combines, he had the biggest tractors in the country. And he was a good guy, hard as hell, but a hell of a good guy, and I learned a lot. So I just started working for him, and the reason he actually employed me was because he had to go and do a part two call up, and he needed someone on the farm. So he said, right, I'm leaving. This is what I want you to do with my wife, Lily May. He's gone for a week. Bob McKenzie phoned me. Listen, we've got a major camp attack. We need you. I'm asking you personally. You must come. So I said, oh, geez, I just got this job. You know, I don't know if I can do that. He said, you're going to do it. He said, I want you. You've got to be there. You're going to be my machine gun. So I said, all right. So came into Harare. Lee was working at Air Rhodesia, and we just started our relationship really. And we were sitting there, all getting our briefing. We weren't allowed to phone anyone. We weren't allowed to tell anybody anything. And it was just amazing to me. All the whole of squadron was there, and all these old buggers I hadn't seen in years. And then it was laid out. This is what's going to happen. And Dad Barry came up to me. He said, Barry, it's happened to me before. You know, they remember that. So I said, yes, remember it. So he said, no. Okay, you're going to have the call sign next to Mackenzie. And we were designated to assault on the road and the river going in, because I had come that way. I knew what I was looking at. So it was all laid out to us, and RAR would be there. And RAR too. There was RAR. It was also there. Yeah. And then RLI, one commander, if I'm right. Mm-hmm. They were on our one side. And we were all going to jump in, and then at the last minute, we were fortunate in that Corslutes, who never liked to jump out of planes, seconded helicopters for us that Oral and I weren't happy with anyway, but we went in. So we were dropped in exactly where we should have been. And the whole op was explained to us that this guy and his jet was going to fly over, and then once they'd all come back again, we would, the Canberras were in, and the Hunters, and we would be going in. And it was surreal in the way that it happened, because as we came in, we and the choppers were actually the luckiest, because we were actually put down exactly where we should have been. Whereas the DAX, there was quite a bit of wind, and the guys were blown into very big trees and lots hooked up in trees, and these guys were running swastikas everywhere. They were just tearing through the bush. But we received the main lot coming towards us, because they'd been hammered by the Canberras, and they were actually shell-shocked. They were like zombies coming out of there, and hundreds of them. And they were mixed. There was pools with, you know, enemy. You couldn't see who was who. And it was just non-stop firing and contacts. And they were firing at us from inside the camp. And there were some AA positions. And then there was like another barracks that side. And we could see, I could still see that same Red Cross ambulance there. We'll see. So what happened to them, I don't know. I never found out. But Mackenzie was very good. He took control of it, because it was pandemonium. Absolutely. If you can imagine thousands and thousands of people trying to get away, and now you're controlling fire groups and liaising. Robinson was excellent. I mean, from the air, obviously, he was controlling overall. But on the ground, physically, what was happening now, here, now, was Mackenzie and Wilson.
Yeah.
But Mackenzie really took charge. And we culled. As I say, I shot 75 people in the first 15 minutes, easy.
Sure.
But, you know, it's, you know, it's just war, you know, you're just fighting. And it was frenzied. I remember when Ross Smith next to me changed his belts 3 times. Now, you're carrying 1,200 rounds of ammo, changed 3 times. And we all carried RPDs, RLI were MAGs, and RAR MAGs. And the K-cars were just going boss. Shooting all over the place. At that stage, we never knew France now had been hit. In fact, we had very little comms with all the groups around us. But we were told, get up, we're Mackenzie's group, we're going to assault through down the road, through the camp. So we went down and we were carrying on, and obviously there was fire coming back, but not hectic at all. And we were just taking targets where we saw them, you know. And the other guys were still having constant stop group shootouts there. Unfortunately, because RLI and RAR were not really well versed in camp attack, they were good in a contact situation, they were allowing people to flee that they thought were civilians, and they were actually not civilians. Ushuwa Kunzi walked straight through one commander, RLI, carrying a baby.
Really?
Yeah, that's how he got out. And we only knew after the fact. So They were doing a good thing, but they were doing a bad thing. They should have just been planting them. Mackenzie told them, he just, I don't know who was in charge of one commander, but he said, your guys better shoot everyone that comes. And then they started to really plant as well. The end of it, as I say, it was clearance right throughout the whole complex and bits of firefights here and there and everywhere. Franz Nell, we knew, had been shot. And then Darrell Watt and them were clearing, they were close to us, they were clearing trenches. And I didn't know Darrell had been shot. But Tony, Tommy guy, lovely guy, good soldier, he dragged Darrell out of the line of fire. And I think Klusniak then shot. So that came, obviously came back to us that he had to go. And at the end of it, as I say, it was more a thing of, geez, we actually did this. We actually did it. And everyone is here, you know. And then it was split up into sections, and we had to try and recover as much documentation, information, any prisoners. We found prisoners locked up in it's difficult to describe it. The Portuguese built these wooden, heavy-duty type buildings there that must have had implements and stuff in that they'd converted to prisons, and they had these guys all inside there. And they were starving and beaten and horrible, horrible conditions. So basically, they called the choppers in to evacuate them, to give them medical treatment. Our medics on the ground, Andy Johnson and them, initially, you know, went to work on these guys, and because they were on near death now. You can't believe that humans will treat each other like that, you know. They've been burnt. And it was men, women, whatever, you know, it was terrible. Anyway, that was sorted out. And then we started airlifting stuff out. We were there overnight, and there were contacts as these guys came back into the camp and thought that we had left. So there was contacts all night. But they airlifted RAR out completely because they weren't that great. They'd actually not really done the job they were supposed to do. So it was us and, well, I think one commander, RLI, I think it was one commander. And we were then put together because there were a lot of vehicles that we'd seconded. Mackenzie driving up and down in one. And we determined that the whole place was clear. And I think one of the call signs of RLI was a stop group on the junction road, the main road coming in. So we needed to get them out of there because it was quite a hazardous situation, because we heard that Frelimo were coming. There was a whole lot of Frelimo coming down, armored, and Tanzanians that had joined up. So then it went the whole night, contacts, etc. Next morning, called together, debriefing. We're going to be picked up. We're going back to New Sierra. RLI, we're going back to their barracks. We were all going to New Sierra. We didn't know why. So he lifted to grab back to Grand Reef, and then from Grand Reef flown back to New Sierra. We get to New Sierra, and we told our guys, get up. We're going to Timbwe. Darrell Watt had done the last recce into Timbwe. And it was more to the north of northern Mozambique. Very harsh area, very, very harsh area. And so we were all divided up again into our various call signs, and we went in to do Timbwe. And it was very interesting going in there because the Dakota pilots had misjudged the height, the altitude. But it was very rough, it was hot, and there were a lot of air thermals, and we were going up and down and up and down. And so we started going out at 600 feet, and the last guys went up at 300 feet. So that it was like hop and pop, you know. But as we were going down, all of the enemy in the camp were looking at us like this. They couldn't believe it. It was like, what is this, you know?
As Joe Cotton would say, yeah. Meat bombs.
Yeah, yeah. So as we came down, the camp was a long, narrow camp in a valley like that. So we were dropped on each side over the edges of the hills. So it was a V like this. So we came in like that. And then the choppers, K-cars down there, because they were obviously going to run that way. But they were so stunned, hardly any of them actually started to run until it was too late. And we killed 900 there that day.
Sure.
Same procedure again, but by that time the guys were buggered. You know, it's in 3 days, no sleep, you know. Collect kit, no one was hit. Everyone was okay. Put everything together, SB came in, walked through the camp, whatever the story is. And that was the other guy with blonde hair, what was his name? And quite a well-known guy.
Winston
Watt. That was his side. Good guy. So we did have prisoners from there. There we had. So we loaded everything up and then we withdrew back again and obviously back to Cabrit. And, you know, we got feedback like a week later. But my experiences of those ops were, it was very intense, two different locations completely. The one lush, thick, huge trees, the other one dry, horrible Mapani, you know, brown, you know. But they were both extremely successful, both extremely successful.
It's interesting what you say, Barry, about the fact that you'd got good to see Rowan Cronier had gone to the Prime Minister.
Yes.
And I'm almost certain what was happening. I mean, Robinson, everybody did now know that that camp was there.
Yes.
And they were itching to attack.
Yeah.
But they couldn't get permission from Comops.
Yes.
And that would have been Flower.
Yes.
He would have been the stumbling block. He kept finding reasons why we shouldn't go on the attack.
Mm.
And it was very frustrating. And so, you know, your little intervention there might have been the trigger.
Exactly.
Because Ian Smith probably, once he, because he wouldn't have known about
this. No, he didn't know about it. Yeah.
But once he heard about it, he probably then went to them and said, hey, if this is the case, you better do something.
Yeah.
And so, you know, you probably, the reason why somebody pulled the trigger.
Yeah, instigated something. Well, just to confirm it, you can speak to Lawrence Castan, because he was with me. Mm. And he probably also has an angle to say.
Barry, were you at Makushi?
Makushi 1, Makushi 2.
With all the women?
That was in Zambia, no.
No. But I know you were involved at the end with Hectic and Quartz.
Yes.
Just talk us through where...
I'm just trying to think back now, because what happened at Makushi as well was, although I wasn't there, I was in Kariba at the time when those ops took place. So I got a lot of feedback from Dave Berry and Co, not Andre Skippers, because he walked into that Pom Z thing. And I'm just trying to think, then after that, one of the ops that we did do in terms of bridge playing, going right back now, and it's getting back to 75, was Northern Mozambique, where we were flown in actually right on the border with Malawi.
Uh-huh.
And we dropped those bridges.
Right.
Yeah. But that was Dave Hodson as well with us. That's 75.
Yeah, and I think Murphy went into Malawi.
That's right. That's right.
The city with an American passport, and then he drove down.
Drove down to us. That's right.
Yeah.
No. But I'm just trying to think at the end of the war, you know, because it was quite confusing right at the end at Bumi, not Bumi, right down at the end of the lake. There's a hotel there, Binga.
Yeah.
Sorry, we were there at the time of those other ops. It was Bruce Reyes and myself, and we had to row across there. And that's when Tim Kutsio came there with an American visitor who they were doing a buffalo study in the valley.
Yeah.
Look, you know, I don't know how that works, but Clem's son and this guy's son wanted to swim. And it was, I think it was October. I think all those ops happened in around about October, if I'm right.
Yeah, I can't remember.
If I remember. And it was, you know, how the valley is then, it's unreal. And these kids wanted to swim. And at Bingo, there's that concrete ramp that goes in the water.
Mm-hmm.
And Ken kept saying, no. And the American being a bit liberal, no, come on, let's just get splash in the water there. And Ken, be careful, I don't want you deeper than this. And we were buying bread rolls from the hotel owner's wife. Lovely woman. He had one leg, that guy. He had a false leg. I can't think of his name.
The leisure resort there.
Yeah. And they had nobody there. It was, you know, she used to bake these nice rolls for us every day. And we heard the screaming and we ran there. And there was a 17-foot crocodile that had this American's kid in its jaws. Rolling, thrashing, you know. And it had obviously taken him off the slipway.
Sure.
So we shot it. I shot it. I had a friend with me. I shot it because nobody, they weren't armed or anything. Killed it, and we got the body back, but he was dead. And we had to use our sabers to drag that flat dog up the... You couldn't pull it up by hand. It was
sure.
huge.
Sure.
Yeah.
No,
it was terrible. It was tragic. Yeah.
What were you supposed to be doing there?
We were actually looking at... actually, it was not me. It was Bruce Fraser. He was looking... We actually paddled him across and dropped him on the other side. They were looking at camps on the other side. Zipra camps on the other side there. Because that's where the confluence was very narrow. And there was an island right in the middle of the Zambezi River there, where it comes into Kariba. And these groups, you know, these enemy would come across there. It was a very easy crossing point to get to Wanki.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
That's called the Narrows, I think.
Yeah. No, Kota Kota Narrows is the other side.
Yeah. But right at the end, when those targets, the film studio, some of the blokes were going to go to the university.
Oh, sorry, in Harare.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, because.
Okay, we were split up right at the end there when everyone was supposed to stay in their barracks and the enemy were. There was a whole lot supposed to be in the university. And
yes.
Then there was. We were given the target in Avondale.
Okay.
ZANU-PF owned a house there.
Yes.
It was some church ministers or something. Daryl Watt's call sign was Mike West. Daryl Watt, I think, I don't know if Howard Muggeridge was there. I must actually ask him still. But there were a couple of them. Okay. They were to target, or not to target, they were supposed to gather intelligence from the university. I was put, funny enough, the person in my call sign was old, the author, old, wrote those books. Yes.
Wilbur Smith's son.
Wilbur Smith's son.
Yes.
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 He had gone AWOL from the Navy here. And he wanted to experience a war, so he said. And he was put with me because I had my civvy vehicle. So they couldn't conduct these information gathering ops in military vehicles because their number plates and what they looked like.
Yeah.
So I had a Datsun 120 wire station wagon. So we were sent with a woman from the military intelligence, SIAC, Psychological Warfare Department, to try and capture someone coming out of that house. We were told we had to drive up behind them, and then if we radioed ahead, they would put a roadblock in and we'd try and, because they needed
information
what these guys were actually going to do.
Yeah.
So, it was all done at night. It was all night stuff, nothing in the day. And what we would do is we would be strategically placed in certain areas and watch the traffic in. And we noticed that there were always a couple of Datsun buckies, these 1800 top, 1500 buckies, I think they were, with canopies on the back and people going in and out. And they weren't supposed to be. So we were then given permission to try and take one of these vehicles when it came out. And we followed him out, and he hid out towards, out of Harare, towards the township, what was it, Chitungwiza, that area. So right past Kabrit, actually, in fact. And we radioed ahead to what's called some, and they blocked him. And Mike West got in and pulled the oak out and slapped him around. And then they got in the vehicle, and there was the guy was in there with his son, actually. So there was a kid in the vehicle. We hadn't seen a kid, because he was below the sill level, you know. There's nothing much you can do about that, you know. So they abducted him and took him back for interrogation. And they did get quite a lot of good information out of that guy. And he was then handed over to that new CIO had been formed, which is now Central Intelligence, INSA. And that was Jake Harper on Walls, Ian Suttle.
Yes.
Those guys. I don't even know who was in charge of them.
Mm.
Yeah. But we never heard. We never heard the result of what actually happened.
And what was your task at,
we were just
If the order had been given.
If the order had been given, and we were waiting for it. Walls was supposed to give us the instruction.
Mm.
And we were going to take them all out.
Mm. In that house?
No, not just that house. The university, everything was prepared. all the camps around the country where United Nations were holding these guys, or were supposed to be holding these guys. And Wilson and Sulu Scouts, Dave Scales, they had been tasked with assassinating Mugabe if he won the election. So they set about their planning with regard to that. And if that assassination took place, we were then tasked to take all of these.
All of these gentlemen.
Sorry.
Unless it didn't happen.
It didn't happen. We were all waiting at Cabrit, all ready. Vehicles prepared, everything prepared. And it never came, and it never came. And we waited the whole night. And then the next day, Wolves was coming to address us. And Mackenzie and I don't think Graham Wilson. Graham Wilson was OC then.
Yeah.
It was Barrett. Met him at the gate and said, "You can't come in. If you come in, they'll kill you." And he said, "I'm the general of the army." They said, "That doesn't matter who you are. They're going to kill you."
Yeah.
And he left. We never saw him again. Never heard him.
Yeah, well, there's a lot of anger, that's right.
Yeah.
Barry, just, I just want Barry to talk a little bit, just fast forward.
Yes.
You're in South Africa.
Yeah.
You're trying to settle down as a city.
Yeah.
Oh, you went.
First, what happened was, you know, when I left, okay, when we decided to leave, because we saw the medical facilities take a hike, and my eldest son was.
Okay, so the war's finished.
It's finished now.
It's over. Yeah. You're living in Zimbabwe now.
Yeah, I had my own business at Empress Nickel Mine. Very successful. We lived well, but we could see the writing on the wall. My son had been in hospital, and Mugabe had thrown all the hospitals open, free hospitalization, and it was a mess. And with my oldest son suffering terribly with infected tonsils, I said to Lee, "Right, that's it. We're calling it a day. We're going to go to South Africa. It's our easiest option at this stage." So we left with our 1,000 rand and our 10-year-old car, and I flew down first to Joburg. And I actually met James Hayden and Barry Deacon there. And Deacon said to me, "No, he's been talking to Wilson and put him in touch with, I don't know who it was. It wasn't Brandenburg at the time. It was someone else. Could have been Lutz, yeah. And they want to set this thing up with
extraditions
or whatever. And am I interested?" So I said, "Well, how much does it pay?" So they said 2,000 a month. So 2,000 rand a month in those days was a fortune, you know. And I'd come with a 10-year-old car. Well, my wife was coming down with a 10-year-old car, and she was pregnant, expecting our daughter and two little boys. You know, your options, you take the best option you can. So we said, "Okay, let's go and see, you know, let's go and find out." In the meantime, Dave Berry was a security officer at Rustenburg Mines and very unhappy. And him and I communicated. We operated a lot together, Hannes,
together. Yeah.
You know? When you talk about fire there, we did that one up into there as well, where we were tasked with trying to get a hostage for intelligence. Also more towards the end of the... We were based in Kanemba, and we had a contact there, and that's where that Pete McLeish said, "Can I throw a grenade? Can I..." We were 100 meters away. "I want to see you throw a grenade 100 meters away." Yeah, this was this heavy oak, ex-Brit SAS, whatever he was, but he was just an arsehole. And anyway, Daryl Watt was also, he had a call sign there, the other side. And Dave and myself initiated the contact. Well, the other guys were actually having a brew behind us, and we prompted a whole lot of them. But they were all dead. We didn't actually have anybody that we could fly out and back again. But anyway, we came down to South Africa. Lee is very well qualified. So the thought was that she could have Sarah down here and she would be a South African citizen. I was a South African citizen because my parents registered my birth down here. So it was the easiest. She's a British citizen and carries a British passport. And once she'd had our daughter, it would be easier for her to get a job than it was actually for me. But this other option came up. So we went for it, and we went and were interviewed by Brattenbach, who I never knew him before I came here.